I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We could have the roll call by the town clerk, please.
Chairman Roberts.
Present.
Counselor Barry.
Here.
Counselor Carson.
Here.
Counselor Fritz.
Here.
Counselor Lynch.
Here.
Counselor McGinty.
Here.
Counselor Swift Kayata.
Here.
Representative Hill. Representative Weaver.
Here.
Manager McGovern.
Here.
And Town Clerk Lane.
Present.
Thank you very much. This evening we have a rather special event scheduled for the first part of the meeting. And I'm going to step down to the podium and ask Evelyn and Jim if they come up and join me. I think everybody knows them, but this is Evelyn and Jim Cox. And tonight, it is my honor to present the Ralph T. Gould Award for 2002. This award was established in 1986, was named for the late Ralph Gould to recognize his community service, and subsequently to recognize those who provide community service in the same spirit as Ralph Gould. Tonight, for the third time since 1986, the award is being given to two individuals who have worked together to serve our community. The 17th and 18th recipients of the Ralph T. Gould Award are Evelyn and Jim Cox, James Cox. I guess we want to get formal in it, don't we? Jim served our country in the United States Marines. Upon returning to Cape Elizabeth, he has continued a strong devotion to public service. He chaired the War Veterans Memorial Committee that restored the War Veterans Memorial on Scott Dyer Road. He oversaw the movement of the memorial when the school project was undertaken 10 years ago. Since that time, he has devoted time and energy to the memorial, from ensuring that the site is well maintained to arranging to have the flagpole illuminated so that the flag would be flown 24 hours per day. Jim is also a longtime volunteer driver for the Cape Elizabeth Rescue, being the most frequent driver of the rescue unit in recent years. No matter what the weather or other obligations he may have, day in and day out, you will see Jim at the wheel of Rescue 1. Most other communities in the area now have full-time coverage during the day. It's only thanks to Jim and Evelyn and a few other volunteers that the towns have been able to continue the rescue services on a call basis for the last few years. Jim has also recently agreed to assume a major new responsibility for the Veterans Day Parade and for the citizens of Cape Elizabeth. He is replacing Jim Murray for that event. Evelyn Cox is captain of the Cape Elizabeth Rescue Company. In this capacity, she provided crucial leadership in recruiting and motivating rescue members and ensuring that the rescue meets all the appropriate standards. She has provided leadership in carrying out decisions on issues when her personal viewpoint was at odds with the majority, and in so doing, has earned deep respect from many in the community. Evelyn has also maintained one of the highest response rates to rescue calls over the last decade. This was during a time when she has had a number of personal challenges when any lesser person could easily have backed away from serving the rescue. Some volunteer agencies, such as hospitals, add up the total numbers of hours served by volunteers. Unfortunately, we do not have a record of hours of those who serve in our community. If we did have to direct it, it would be clear that there was no couple in Cape Elizabeth who, over the last decade, had given more time to Cape Elizabeth than Evelyn and Jim Cox. On behalf of the entire town council and the citizens of Cape Elizabeth, it gives me great pleasure to present Evelyn and Jim Cox the 2002 Ralph Gould Award. And you have earned it. I guess I'd like to add, particularly for the people at home, that the council chamber is full, and I have a feeling that shortly it won't be. The folks are here for Evelyn and Jim. And Evelyn and Jim, there's a permanent plaque that's also mounted in the council chamber with your name on it for everyone to see. And again, thank you very much.
Thank
I'll get back to work.
For those of you that couldn't hear that over the mic for the TV, I think the dispatcher was giving his congratulations as well over the broadcast system. And I'm going to wait just a second. I think the people clear out so we don't have too many interruptions while we're doing our reports. We can move on. I guess the first thing I'd like to do is just welcome Alex. This is your first meeting. If you have anything you'd like to say when we're on different items, be sure and put your hand up. Councilor Carson's mic is handy. You'll have to get up and perhaps speak over there, but we welcome your comments and Rhiannon's as well each evening. So. We now can move on to reports and correspondence. Any of my fellow councilors have anything they'd like to bring forward this evening?
Well, really, I just wanted to note, and I think most of the councilors have seen their packet in front of them, which pertains to the school project, and I just wanted to note for the public that there will be a workshop on Tuesday, January 21st, in which the town council will be briefed on the school project. So that's an opportunity for the public to attend and find out more about the proposal.
Thank you.
Just a note, a reminder that dog licenses are due for all the doggies in the community by the end of this month.
Thank you so much. Anyone else have anything? I've got several things I would like to bring up this evening, some good and some not so great. But first off, I'd like to recognize Carl Hegeman, a local student here in Cape Elizabeth, who recently earned his Eagle badge. Congratulations to Carl. Need to send out condolences to Harry Proudman. Harry is our cable TV director. His wife, Val, died at Christmas time. There will be a memorial ceremony later this month, and hopefully members of the council can get to that as well. We can send out congratulations to Matt and Amy Sturgis, our tax assessor, on the birth of Eliza Jane. She was born on Christmas, so they had a new little present that they will get to enjoy for years to come. And I need to mention that the town has lost a very good employee to retirement. Bob Lehman, who served as the canine or animal control officer for a number of years, has retired, so I'm sure we will miss Bob's services as well. And then I had a busy month as well. Went snow plowing with Bib Jordan this past month during one of the heavy snowstorms. Extremely interesting. I got to actually work the wing on the plow, and to my knowledge, I only took out one mailbox. It was buried. You couldn't see it. I didn't do it intentionally. And I might add that traveling with a snow plow man is probably something that all of our planning board directors and all of our developers ought to do. Bib, that goes down by the lighthouse, and getting around those dead-end streets, it took him a half an hour to back in and out. It's dead-end streets. They're really bad news. Met with the Conservation Commission. I stopped by their meeting to thank them for all their efforts on the Gulfcrest plan. And as part of our council goal to have as many councilors meet with the boards and commissions, I went to the Arts Commission meeting last week. So we can log that one down as one that we've attended. So with that, I will ask the town manager if how we'd like to follow that.
Very briefly, I want to follow up a little bit on what the chairman has said about the Public Works crew. Ever since Christmas night, they've been out almost continuously, and in fact, we had 5 out of the last 7 days prior to this weekend, we had plowable snow, which in our memory is the longest we had gone, the most number of times we had gone in such a short period having to plow snow. And they are all guys. These guys are out there, hour after hour, night after night, and I think the community really owes them a great debt of gratitude for first beginning on their work on Christmas night and ever since. You know, in the lighter winters, they're still ready to do it, but it's really good to see them doing it during the winters that we're the winter that we're experiencing this year. So I thank them, and I know the council joins in thanking the Public Works crew as well.
Absolutely. Debbie, anything you'd like to add?
Henry stole my thunder.
Henry stole it.
Dog licenses were due January 1st. If you license them by January 31st, you avoid a late fee. Late fee will begin February 1st. So,
I'll let you mention nomination papers on. Well, you can mention it. That's on the website. Huh?
Nomination papers for Town Council School Board will be available beginning in mid-February. I apologize. The date escapes me. It is on the website. Anyone interested in running for Council or School Board, there are 3 seats available on each, and they are 3-year terms. So, again, please contact me if you need more information.
Thank you. And we have some citizens in the audience tonight, so citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Is there anyone that would like to get up for a moment and speak of anything on that you have of concern? Nope. Good. All right. So we can move right on then to the minutes of December 9. Can I have a motion for approval?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Carol?
I just have a correction on the first item. Where sophomore Henry Kramer, he was the winner of a piano competition. It wasn't a recital.
Okay. Yep. Duly noted. No further discussion. All in favor? I'm sure it'd be unanimous. Our first item this evening would be item number 69-02-03. It is a public hearing, and the public is welcome to speak on this item. It is a public hearing on a golf course zoning amendment, consideration of adoption of proposed amendments to the zoning amendment ordinance relating to golf courses and golfing-related activities. And John, that's through the ordinance committee. Would you be interested in give us any comments?
Sure. This is
okay.
Amendment.
John, might have you hold off just 1 second. Carol, I told Carol I'd give her a chance to get in here.
Yeah, I just need to abstain from participating in this issue because I'm a stockholder at Perpudic, so don't want to have any conflicts there.
Okay, so we need to vote.
I'll move that Councilor Fricks be recused from voting on this issue.
Second.
All in favor? And you can show that to be unanimous as well. Thank you, Carol. John, sorry about that.
That's okay. This is a draft of an amendment to the zoning ordinance. What we discovered was that we have a golf course in town, Puta Club, which is not covered by definition in the zoning ordinance, and so I guess officially doesn't exist. So the ordinance committee looked at, and the golf course exists obviously, but didn't exist in the zoning ordinance. What we did, we put together definitions of what a golf course is, what golf course related activities are, and we defined what a miniature golf course is. We also looked at the RA district, what permitted uses should be for the RA district, and included a golf course in that, in which Paputa Club does exist now. And we also looked at the RB zone and made some definitions of what were permitted uses in the RB zone. For the RA zone, the change is to add the following non-residential permitted uses, and that is a golf course and golf course-related activities. And for the RB zone, we added as permitted activities, for permitted uses, non-residential uses, golf course-related activities, excluding restaurants, clubhouses, and meeting halls. And by way of definition, golf course definition is a tract of land laid out for at least 9 holes for playing the game of golf and improved with tees, greens, fairways, and hazards. A miniature golf facility is not a golf course. Golf course-related activities is defined as uses such as a tennis court, swimming pool, parking lot, driving range, clubhouse, restaurant, or meeting hall, and maintenance buildings, any of which may be rented out for events, which is located on a lot under common ownership with a lot where a golf course is located. And a miniature golf course is defined as a tract of land laid out for playing miniature golf, where all holes are separated by barriers and the only clubs used in the course are putters. We also define the minimum lot size in an RA zone for a golf course as 150 acres. And I believe those are the only changes, or those are the changes recommended.
All right. Thank you very much. Is there any member of the public that would like to speak to this item? Please state your name and address, and thank you.
I'll turn this so I can get toward you. Thank you. Tom Michinelli, 6 Phillip Road. I am a member of Proputic Golf Course, Golf Club, and I am the chairperson of the Long Range Plan Committee, which deals with issues in the club over a course of time. I've just taken over this position recently, and I'm here to support the amendment to change the ordinance and the zoning for the course. It is important to the membership. We have land adjacent to our current golf course that we have been paying taxes on for a number of years, and we have not developed that property, and we've not really been able to establish any dialogue with our membership because of the restrictions on the land right now. We don't really plan to do this immediately, but it certainly would help us if this proposal was approved and by the council, that give us an opportunity to present to the membership some options. So I'm here to support that and in hopes that the council would see light in favor of that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else who would like to speak to this item?
Hello, Mr. Chairman and members of the council. My name is John Green. I am the manager of the Sprint Corporation. I'd like to thank the council for considering this ordinance change. First, I'd like to say that we do support the Proputa Club's interest in possible expansion. As a representative of a large landowner in town, I believe this is an opportunity for the town to offer a few remaining large acreage property owners in town an option other than residential development. The comprehensive plan states that the town should develop dialogue with larger property owners in order to discuss how best to preserve open space. In the residential zone in the town ordinance does not offer us landowners many options other than residential development. Does the town need another golf course? Perhaps not. Does the town need residential development or another subdivision? Most definitely not, perhaps at least in our area. With the threat of increasing property taxes, it's becomes clear that we need other options, and this is an opportunity for the council to add in the RA zone at least another option for us to consider. So we really appreciate looking at this, and it'd be unfortunate if we had to take the path of development, but I guess we would prefer other options such as a golf course, and this is an opportunity to at least add one more item to the list. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Mr. Chairman, members of the council, my name is Craig Cooper. I own Rainbow Construction. I'm a resident here at Cape Elizabeth, a home builder here in Cape Elizabeth. I've built a number of residential homes here, and I am a member of Proputa Golf Course. I find myself on both sides of this coin, but I strongly feel personally I'd like to see this amendment pass. And I, while it's my own personal livelihood and I enjoy building houses for people here in Cape Elizabeth, I think there are enough opportunities to do that and not enough opportunity for the open space that this passing of this amendment might allow. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? All right, we can declare the public hearing closed. Do we have a motion to discuss?
But prior to that, Chris, I said that we did receive an email, I don't know if it came as a letter originally to from Mr. KJ Keller, who is an abutter, I believe, of this property, and has addressed us previously on this issue. He was invited to our ordinance committee meetings, didn't attend for whatever for reasons, but he sent not lengthy, but at least a page long letter in opposition to this. And his main concern is it appears to be
spot zoning, and that it particularly is, the focus is for, on the Booty Club to develop this particular parcel, as opposed to widening the zoning for the entire town, or at least for the RA and the RB zones. And I think it needs to be included as part of the record that he is opposed to this for that particular reason, and raises some questions, most of which I might add that we brought up at our meeting. We addressed most of his concerns, even though I wasn't there, we addressed most of his concerns. I myself tried to play the devil's advocate and bring up all the things that could go wrong or might go wrong, or we need to look at this from every direction. And after doing that, I'm fairly satisfied that we have addressed his concerns and that it doesn't constitute spot zoning, because it does involve RB and the RA zones across the entire town. I just wanted to bring that up, that he did send that email.
Thank you.
There's some questions.
Actually, we should have somebody make a motion.
I would move adoption of the proposed golf course zoning amendment, the one that was in our draft, the draft that was in our package.
Second.
Do we have a second? And a second. Okay, discussion.
You go. You had some concerns and you voiced them.
All right, sure. Generally, I don't get to go first. And I think perhaps maybe some of my fellow counselors can answer some of my questions that I had. But Mr. Keller did bring up a couple of things in his memo that I at least wanted to have aired publicly so we know where we stand on it. And he'd spoken about the issue of common ownership as opposed to contiguous. I'm not sure if contiguous, adjacent, or common needs to be in there. But under this proposal, if the Papuda Club or the golf course owned by the Sprague Corporation or by the Maxwells or anybody else, if they owned a parcel of land off-site, well away from where they have their golf course, could they put in any of these ancillary uses on that site?
John,
Yes, please, go ahead.
I'm a member of the Ordinance Committee, and as I recall, we had a discussion that touched on this issue at our Ordinance Committee meeting, and Maureen O'Meara, who is our planning person, discussed the meaning of common ownership, and as I recall, common ownership meant that it is, that I am not a lawyer, so, and I'm not a planning expert, but as I recall, when we discussed this, we had the same question Mr. Keller brings up, and she said that common ownership meant common ownership, meaning it's touching, it's right next door, or across the street counts. There's two lots that are side by side. So in my mind, that would mean contiguous. Again, that's just my recollection of what happened at the Ordinance Committee, but I would look, does either one of the other ordinance people recall that's part of the discussion?
That doesn't say the same thing to me. Common ownership means ownership by the same entity, whether it's a person, a corporation, or a partnership, or some other entity, two parcels that would be owned by the same entity. And contiguous means abutting. Okay.
I understand that point, which was Mr. Keller's point. I'm just relating what I recall of our conversation
sure.
with Ms. O'Meara, and she indicated that common ownership would suffice in her professional opinion. That's my recollection.
Okay. The other question that I had, and I think Councilor Lynch answered some of it this earlier, but I'd like to, I guess, have it as part of the record. If something could go into say in the RA zone, a restaurant, tennis courts, swimming pools, etc. In an RA zone, the setback requirement on like a garage or a house or whatever is 30 feet from the side lot line. Parking lots typically don't have a setback. You could put that right up to the line. What protection would a homeowner have to make sure that something like that was not set right on the property line or within 30 feet of the property? And what kind of buffers and whatever. And
what this does is allow this as a permitted use. It would still have to go to the planning board for site plan review, and this was something that we discussed at some length in the ordinance committee, and we were satisfied that the requirements that the planning board would look at and apply to this kind of development would be sufficiently rigorous to provide for integrity to the development, if you will. And, but, you know, it would be the normal parking lot requirements, whether it's plantings and that sort of thing.
Island.
But it is not a case where tomorrow the Proputic Club can go in and pave a parking lot. They'll have to go to this planning board and seek site plan review.
Would that be a question of judgment on the part of the planning board as to whether it was appropriate or what standards are used for this?
I believe that there are standards in the ordinance that they would have to apply.
Fine. Is the other side of Spruing Avenue in the entire property in an RB zone?
That particular area is yours.
Yeah.
Which zone?
But there's RAs on either side of those lots, right? You say that the land directly across the street, as we're thinking about on this, is an RB zone? I can't remember the zone.
Yeah, it's RB.
Yes, it's
the
RB.
The piece that Proputic owns.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Is RB.
And on either side of it is RA.
Some is RB and some is RA.
Yeah, it's
okay.
Regular
RA.
Would you like
okay.
to see the map?
Yeah, I actually looked it up. I can't mm-hmm. remember what was on either side.
But you've answered most of my questions, other than one on the common ownership. I'm not sure I'm real comfortable with that. I'd rather see a property that lies adjacent or contiguous as opposed to use common, because I think I could see that being exploited in the future. But if there, you can also?
Absolutely.
And
I can't recall what the downside was of not using that term. I do agree with Councillor Cayetta that we had that discussion, and now I'm getting a little fuzzy on it too, and why we didn't have contiguous in there. If anybody, Marianne, do you remember?
I honestly don't recall. I will say though, I'm a little reluctant to add language tonight that we haven't discussed with the town planner. I would feel more comfortable adopting this as it's drafted, and then if there is an issue that we can come back and amend it, any one of us who can bring it back as an amendment.
As long as we can get that reviewed and make sure you get a legal opinion on it, because I don't want to leave that hanging there, but I do want to make sure the Proputic Club is able to do what they need to do to remain viable, but I want to make sure we're not setting ourselves up for a real problem 10 or 15 years down the road with somebody else.
Well, I think we could look at it sooner than 10 or 15 years, but
we'd look at it quickly and get it changed if that language should be tightened.
I don't know when Maureen is due back to work.
She's available for some consultation.
Presentation. We can do that. I mean, as a chairman of the ordinance committee, I would make that commitment.
Right.
We look at that sooner than later. Because that kind of raises that question in my mind, too. I think we were satisfied at the time, at least the three of us on the ordinance committee were satisfied at the time that it addressed that need, and I guess I just can't articulate it
as
well as
Maureen
does. Yeah,
we don't have the expertise to explain it.
Yeah, exactly.
All right, as long as everybody's willing to readdress that particular item.
Absolutely.
If necessary.
If necessary, right, if we get an interpretation.
Can we set a date for it? I mean, like next month or?
No, I don't think anybody's going to run out and try to buy a piece of property just so they can stick something on it. I don't think we need to worry about that.
Well, I don't mind.
To start with.
Yeah, they're going to own a golf course to start with, yeah.
I don't mind, as Councillor McGinty said, committing as a member of the ordinance committee that we'd meet in the next month.
Yeah. Sure.
Now, I'd be.
We'll make that commitment, Jack. We'll meet on this issue within the next month.
Very good. Works for me.
Great.
Councilor Carson?
It works for me. I did have some concerns. I did spend some time discussing this, and I did have some concerns, but I feel quite comfortable now, especially with looking into the ownership issue, so I'm happy to support it.
Very good. Any further discussion? All right, why don't we vote on it? All in favor of the ordinance language as presented. Show it to be unanimous. Thank you, folks.
Get it, speaker.
Item number 70-0203, public hearing on open space zoning amendment. Consideration of adoption of the proposed amendments to the zoning ordinance relating to density standards in overlapping districts. And John, I believe you're chair on this one as well.
As well. This involves the our open space zoning amendment. The planning board brought to us a situation or an ambiguity in the zoning that as concerning open space zoning and cluster development, and it clarifies that if a subdivision includes two or more zoning districts, the density shall be calculated based on the requirements of each district, and then the actual development location can occur on the parcel independent of the zoning district lines as long as the overall development density is not exceeded. And previously, if we had a subdivision that overlapped on each zoning, they had to be done independently. This kind of combines them, and you still have to determine the density based on each zone, but then you can place it within the overall subdivision, as long as the overall density isn't exceeded. Hope I said that.
And the ordinance committee is recommending this.
And we are recommending. Yes, we are recommending.
All right. And this.
We should point out that it enhances the ability to maintain open space because you can move the development where it makes the most sense on a particular piece of property.
Absolutely.
All right. Thank you. And this is a public hearing. Is there anyone in the public that would like to speak to this? All right. Seeing no one, have a motion to move this forward.
I'll move this amendment. Second.
And a second. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? You've got to love those easy ones. Item number 71-0203, approval process for various state licenses. Debbie, you get to explain this one.
Thank you very much. This recommendation is a request of the council for staff to look at the approval process for various state liquor licenses. I believe what I have drafted before you is really in line with what the council thoughts were of perhaps it really is a staff duty to approve such licenses. On the first page of this, we're talking about the one-day and the one-time events, for instance, the BYOB and license for incorporated civic organizations, which you folks have seen in the last couple of months. What this does is it puts a responsibility, as it is now, on the applicant to provide an application to the town and to provide it to us an appropriate amount of time for our public safety chiefs and the code enforcement officer to review the application. If there are no concerns or objections, then the town clerk or deputy could sign the license. If there are objections from either staff or perhaps a member or members of the public, then we would ask the applicant to move forward to a regular council meeting. And the second, on the second page, we go into Beano Bingo or other games of chance. The reason why I included this is something that you folks could see. We have seen in the past games of chance from the Papuda Club. I would recommend that the council follow past practice for these type of licenses, that the applicant, again, would be responsible to obtain the licenses and get it into us actually for a regular council meeting. I don't see that this really is where staff wants to step in. You'll see in the survey, I believe I put on the back from other communities that this is not a typical license that is approved by staff without, again, full council review. On the second page, at the end, I included just really a reminder or an affirmation of the current practice for catering licenses. Even before my appointment back in 1986, the town clerk or deputy could approve those type of licenses. I believe the theory behind that was caterers have appropriate insurances and different things to provide liquor off-site through their license through the state. I don't see that practice to change at all. And lastly, something that you see on an annual basis from several businesses in town are annual liquor licenses, a special amusement permit. Just a few short years ago, the council and staff reviewed that process. We did do some changes, and you will find that process in the Code of Ordinances, Chapter 5, under commercial licenses and permits. So again, basically what this does is it leaves the responsibility with the applicant to obtain the necessary licenses from the appropriate state agency to provide it to the town in ample time for us to make our reviews on the staff level. Assuming everything is okay, then we would approve it on the staff level. And again, I believe this is in line with what the council had wanted to see. I did check with other municipalities, and basically the larger type municipalities, they do a staff review in-house and approval by the clerk's office, similar to what we've approved here, except for games of chance, bingo and vino, that seems to be kept on the municipal officer level. So I would recommend that you approve the policy, if you will, as presented.
All right, thank you very much. I realize this came from the council, but by any chance, do you have any language as to how the motion should be made, or does one of the councilors want to step forward with it?
To approve the policy as presented. I would like to see these two pages in our policy manual, just in case anyone does question catering and annual liquor. You know, they may down the road question why we may have left it out. I just think this is more of a putting everything together so someone could look at it, you know, to see everything
all right.
at once.
Councilor Berry has indicated he's prepared to make a motion.
I would make such a motion to approve these two pages. I think that the council is the legislative body that deals with matters of policy, and it may be not just a ministerial function as is proposed here that should be performed by the clerk. So I would support this. I think that's appropriate to be done by the staff rather than a policy matter to be considered by the council. I did notice one thing in the language here. It says a BYOB function. And I'm impressed with the sophistication of the community or the staff presuming that everyone in this community knows what BYOB knows. And perhaps we should spell it out that it means bring your own bottle of an alcoholic beverage nature.
That language I took right off the application, but I'd be happy to to add that as well, sir.
Okay.
Second.
So was there a motion in there, Henry, somewhere?
He motioned and I seconded.
Okay. I motioned right in the beginning there.
Any discussion? Councilor Swift-Cayetta.
I have one question for the clerk. In the 4th bullet down on the first page, it says the application must be submitted to the town within sufficient time for processing. Do we have some indication of what specific time would be? Do we want people to, what would you like to see?
I would like to see at least a couple of days so that I can get in contact with the public safety chiefs and the code enforcement officer. And particularly if there is a concern or objection on an application, we'll need time to tell the applicant, which they will know up front as well, when the deadline is for the next, you know, council meeting as well.
Maybe we should just be more specific if it meets your needs.
Say 2 weeks prior to or something.
You know, whatever.
Yeah, what we try to avoid is someone coming in at 3:00 in the afternoon
exactly.
for a 7:00 function, and that could very well happen.
Because
I'm not saying we couldn't process in that. Well, actually, they would need to get it to the state agency within 72 hours. But
if it's your professional okay. opinion that 2 weeks would be the right amount, the minimum amount of time to sort of guarantee that it gets done, maybe we should just put it in on this and on the next page.
I'd be comfortable even with a week.
Okay.
Well, whatever. So
whatever.
Five business
because
days?
I can see somebody arguing, you know what I mean, mm-hmm. they're under a deadline and saying, yeah. well, it should be sufficient one
I'd amend
one
my
day.
Motion to put the words one calendar week in there.
And again, that
five
to clarify for our processing, and they still need to be this.
Yeah.
This
it's whatever you think you need.
Okay, that 1 week would be great. Thank you.
One calendar week?
Council McGinty.
No, that's fine. I have another issue. And I wonder if we are opening ourselves up to any sort of legal notification where it says residents have an opportunity to oppose this. Right. If a resident doesn't know about it, how are they going to oppose it?
I had that same question, and I'm not there's no notice, correct?
I, after talking to other municipalities, you know, you're trying to get a feel of what others may or may not deal with or what languages they may have to cover this, and I didn't want to exclude someone perhaps that is an abutter to a hall, a grange, a church, or whoever might be holding a function, a municipal hall, whatever, to do that, and that's why I put that in there. But you're right, there are no provisions, and I'm not sure that we want to go that route.
Well, that, I guess I'm trying to throw the monkey wrench here and say, okay, now it's 5 o'clock, that 7 o'clock thing, and my resident walks in and says, hey, I just found out an hour ago that, you know, my neighbor's having this big BOYB thing, because they're putting up a tent or something, you know, and they go, I'm opposed to it. Now what?
Right.
I mean,
you've been on the ordinance committee, I can tell.
Well, just invite them.
No, I think you make a good point.
That's the key answer.
It may be unlikely, but it could be disastrous for whoever's having the event if suddenly someone pops up and says, I oppose, and then they have to wait 3 weeks for a council meeting. So
in any of those other communities, did they have any, do you remember when you called them up, they had any particular notice? Because it is a valid point. We notice for everything else.
No, they don't.
We probably should strike that particular paragraph.
That's fine. Again, I was just trying to be sensitive to a potential neighbor. I didn't want to exclude them, thinking if they come in and object, well, you know, tough cookies, our staff didn't, so we're going to go ahead. But I would be comfortable in striking that, and if an objection came up, taking it, you know, from there, if anything, notifying the state and saying, hey, look, this went through our approval, the neighbor just found out, and then maybe working with the state to see, you know, what it would happen from there. I wouldn't want to exclude any member or any potential member of the public from
I guess it
objecting.
Goes back. Maybe we need to be a little more specific on what we would do if a person objects and at what time, they, you know, they have within 72 hours or prior to the event they can object or something like that. And you're just shaking your head. You know,
perhaps, considering this is sort of our first trial run of this, perhaps a good way to go might be to strike this paragraph on this first page and in the same paragraph on the second page. And, you know, we'll see how it goes. We'll reevaluate it in 6 months or 12 months. And if there's been a big hoo-ha, I'm sure we'll hear about it. And we can amend it if necessary. But I think it might be better if Councillor Berry is willing to just strike that. He's already amended his motion.
I'm making
it
flexible.
Since we're going the route of rather than putting on amendments to amendments, we're just going to rewrite the Councillor Berry's first proposal, and it now has the other language, and that's been deleted. So we're there at that point. Any further discussion? Or are we ready to vote on it?
No, I'm ready to second with the two changes.
Okay. Very good.
So the two changes, again, are elimination of the last paragraph?
Correct.
And we would ask for 1 week processing time for an application.
And it would be elimination of the last paragraph in the section that says one day, one time events, and the section that says Beano Bingo. Yes.
Very good. All in favor of the town clerk now administering these policies as written? Oh, and I think you can show to be unanimous. Yes, you can.
Luck.
Piece of cake, don't worry about it. The next item on the agenda, item number 720203, a request to consider copying fees, request from Councillor Berry to review photocopying fees at the Thomas Memorial Library. Councillor Berry is here to bring forth the rationale.
I asked that this be put on the agenda in response to Jay Sherman's letter to the Council about copies, and perhaps he can explain the experience at the library with the copy machine. He's right here. And,
Jay, would you like to speak to this issue, would you?
I'm still trying to figure out his email.
I have to say, Jay,
yes.
that was a very thorough report. I mean, I now know how many pages are used in the copy machines and how many reams that you bought. I mean, I was really impressed with the kind of tracking that you did. I mean, you were right down to the ink.
The devil's in the details, right, Jay?
Yeah.
Whoa. I think that the salient point that the council needs to consider is simply that since the new fee structure went in place in July, we have had a dozen documented complaints. Four mentions of complaints in the survey, and as I said in my email, there's no way of knowing whether they duplicate previous, and an undocumented number of walkouts. People who, before my staff realized that they had a problem, people who just walked out in protest, I suppose would be the proper term. I think that what the council needs first and foremost to do is decide what it is that you're trying to accomplish with that fee structure. If we're looking to simply offset the public cost of the machines, then it's one course of action that we're going to pursue. If we're looking to offset the total cost of operating those machines within the facility, then we come to a different conclusion. And if what we're really looking for is revenue enhancement, you know, where we're not really concerned with the, you know, the payback on the machine, but we're just looking at one more way to make money, then that may take us down a third course. I guess what I'm proposing at this point is that based on the numbers that I have tried to present to you, and based on some understanding of the structure of copying fees in libraries around the state, not necessarily a very large sampling, 30 out of about 300, but that's a statistically valid sampling. I would propose that we amend Henry's basic motion and simply bring in a fee structure that says 15 cents for any single-sided copy, a quarter for any double-sided copy, and we'll go back to the free reference copy. It's a straightforward system. It should net us enough money so that the machine pays for itself. And from the comments that we've been hearing from the public, most of them have been willing to accept an increase in the fee structure. They realized that the fee structure was very reasonable. It was the size of the increase that was upsetting to people.
Could you give me your numbers again?
The proposal that I'm putting in front of you, 15 cents for any single-sided copy.
Yeah.
And a quarter for any duplex copy, regardless of size. And we would encourage the public to use two-sided copies as often as possible.
I was also amazed at the number of copies that you produce for members of the public. I was stunned. I mean, these are people who simply are not going to drive down to the copy center down at Mill Creek. They're using the library as the copy center. I mean, I was really surprised. And I thought when we first brought this up, you know, so that's a few people. I had no idea that we were talking several reams of paper in the course of a year.
Oh, indeed we are.
Tens of reams of paper.
Mm. Councilor Swift-Kiata.
I was going to make a motion.
Sam?
Well, I'd just like to make a motion to accept the library director's proposal of 15 cents for a single-sided page, 25 cents for a double-sided page, and going along with the previous, with the reference copying policy laid out.
Second. Thank you. And there was a second over there, was it?
I'd second.
Any further discussion? Councilor Fritz?
I had a question. When you were talking about, was it when residents were paying 10 cents, was that when they were still subsidizing the cost to the town? Was 10 cents covering the cost?
At 10 cents, the cost for all of the public's copies are, in fact, covered. They pay a sizable portion of the town's actual cost as well. It depends. If you take into account the capital cost of purchasing the machines, and you take into account some labor cost, then probably, ultimately, they're subsidizing the town's cost to the neighborhood 5 to 10%
at 10 cents.
At the previous buying fee structure.
Right. So that, you know, I guess I'm not feeling it was necessary to raise it. I didn't feel it was necessary to raise it at all previously. but 10 cents still seems to be a reasonable fee if it's covering the cost of, and plus a little additional for any help that people need, and then 15 cents for a double-sided. I would prefer to go back to the old fee. I thought it was...
I believe part of the original proposal was revenue enhancing, and we had raised costs elsewhere as well, but Councilor Swift-Gatta?
Well, I would respectfully disagree with Councilor Fritz. I think we should go with Jay's proposal for a couple of reasons. One is, first of all, I think he's got the best handle on the issue.
Yeah.
And I think this is really getting down to a pretty low level. So I think Henry was talking about us making policy decisions before. But aside from that, I can offer some little tiny reasons, too. I think that his proposal will generate $3,000 to $3,500 a year and will cover copier costs. And I think that's a good thing, given the state of the budget that's coming up this year. I think it's a 40% reduction from the current 25-cent rate, so I think it will be perceived very favorably by consumers, customers, citizens. Jay, in his professional opinion as library director, has told us that he thinks it will satisfy most of the complainants, the 4% of survey respondents who had some concern of one level or another. And lastly, the prevailing competitive rate, according to what Jay has figured out, is 15 cents. And I really can't see why we should be below the prevailing competitive rate. I understand for service reasons why we may not want to be above the competitive rate, but I don't think we should be below the competitive rate because I don't think we're running a copy center. It's a service for citizens, and I think that's a very good thing, but I don't want to be attracting people in there because we're the cheapest rates around, not the cheapest rates around, but cheaper rates than other places. So for those reasons, I'd like to go with Jay's proposal.
Thank you.
I agree.
Councilor Baring.
Just a quick comment that the county in the probate court and in the registry of deeds charges $1.50 per page now for copies. So I think Jay's proposal is most reasonable.
Councilor McGinty?
The last line in your email said this is below what the trustees have recommended. Are they okay with this current proposal? I mean, I'm fine with it.
I believe that they would be fine with it, John. I'll meet with them Thursday. And I can't conceive of how they would have supported a higher rate and be uncomfortable with a lower.
Thank you. I'm ready to vote.
I'm ready.
Let's vote. All in favor of the 1525 proposal? All opposed? Carol, right in the middle there.
We went I'm really not, but...
You know. I guess you could be unanimous.
Wave.
Jay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Item number 730203, Appointments Committee Report. I believe this is... am I on the right one? Nope. I'm sorry, I'm misreading here. Appointments Committee.
You're
right.
Okay, approval of the reappointments of the Riverside Thamet Trustees and the Zoning Board of Appeals. Penny, can you explain what's happening with that one?
Yes, just to explain to members of the public, for any of those that might be watching, when we made our report, from the Appointments Committee made a report to the Council for appointments of new members to various boards and commissions in the town, we neglected to list off the reappointments to commissions, people who were serving in second term. So I would like to put their names forward now as Stephen D. LaPlante was to be reappointed to the Zoning Board of Appeals for the term to expire January in 2006. And Frank Levitt was to be appointed to the trustees of the Riverside Cemetery for his term to expire on January 2006.
Could you put that in the form of a motion? Then?
I move that we accept those two recommendations for reappointment to the
sessions.
Seconded.
On the committee.
Is there any discussion on this item? Seeing none, all in favor? Show it to be unanimous. Item number 740203, Riverside Cemetery burial fees. Consideration of the approval of fees for burials at Riverside Cemetery. And I would ask the town clerk if she would give a brief explanation of that one for us.
I'd be happy to, thank you. You generally see this item in March or April of each year. However, we have had requests from funeral directors in order so that they can, through the winter, get their figures together and so forth for families who lose loved ones during the winter so that they don't have to wait till the spring to confirm what their final costs will be. Sorry that didn't really come out right, but
we know.
Thank you very much. So this is out of respect for the funeral directors. Bob Nally, Jim Green, and myself met on the burial fees. We have just finished our second full year of complete services for the Public Works Department at Riverside. It is going along very well. We looked at the amount of time it takes for burials and things of that nature that is involved. We are happy to report that the 2003 season, we can once again hold burial fees. This will be the third consecutive year. Again, as it says in my memo, we will be reviewing this on an annual basis. What next year will bring, I don't know. But again, this will be the third year. We do recommend an adjustment to the foundation fee from 30 cents to 40 cents per square inch. Again, having now 2 years of history on foundations, which we had absolutely no history before, we found that it was actually costing the town to put in our foundations. We were not charging enough, simply. So we would recommend that the placement of foundation fee go to 40 cents per square inch. So I would recommend that you set the burial fees and foundation fees as presented for the 2003 burial season.
Thank you. Motion to
accept. I make a move. I move.
You make a move?
I move.
You make a move.
Second. As presented by the town clerk.
We have two motions and 3 seconds. Any discussion on this item? All in favor? Show it to be unanimous. And item 7502.03, Spurwink Church Use Provisions. Consideration of an amendment to the use provisions for the Spurwink Church. And I believe Michael indicated he would address this one.
I was so quiet, I was beginning to think I was in Freeport.
Ooh. But you were in the light, not in a dark corner.
Sitting in a corner.
More serious note. The Spurwink Church, some folks occasionally find they need to cancel reservations. If they're quite a bit in advance, there's really very little cost to the town. And sometimes folks have to cancel them. We've had instances in the last couple of years that one of the parties planning to get married died, and it was very awkward not to be able to return it, since the policy specifically had said no refunds. And we've also had instances that things, for whatever reason, didn't work out prior to the wedding. that was a polite way to say that. So, you know, and we do refund for a resident, and the non-residents need to pay. They invest $325 in the church. It's felt that if we hear about it more than 6 months in advance, we ought to give them a refund, with the exception of the security deposit for $100. Otherwise, if it's within the last 6 months, there's no refund at all. But it does take into account some of the situations we've been finding ourselves. What usually happens is Janet Hannigan, who does a great job as the church greeter, she gets a vocal treatment from the person who's unhappy, and then they call me, and I get about 20 minutes, and I understand their concern, and I would encourage the adoption of this amendment.
Do we have a motion to accept the use amendment?
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor? Not that I'm trying to move things along here. Item 7602.03, proposed change in the personnel code. You're going to be on a roll here now, Mike.
Yeah, I'll try. Did you recognize me?
Yes.
Oh, good. This proposed change, we've found, particularly in the swimming pool, that we have mother-daughter teams who lifeguard, swim, instruct. We've had a set of twins who lifeguard. And the pool, Sue Weatherby said today when we went over this at the department head meeting, that the pool simply would not be able to be open if we didn't have some flexibility, particularly because swimming runs in families. So proposing is that we do allow a spouse, a parent, a son, daughter, grandchild, grandparent, brother, sister, or the spouses of any of them to work in the same department, provided that that one of them is a part-time person who does not work a set schedule. The provision is that as long as the second person didn't work a set schedule, we would allow a second person
from those relationships to work in the same department.
Councilor Barry.
What's the objection?
To having folks that are related to each other
work
in the same department. It's basically an issue of office conflicts that can, or departmental conflicts that can occur. You can also get into issues, particularly with full-time positions, of one person may be in a supervisory position, and there's this sense of favoritism of one person over the other. Because these, under this proposal, they're not set schedules. The good thing about it is, if we did begin to have problems, we just wouldn't ask that person to come in on the irregular basis that they now come in. We'd just kind of wean ourselves away from it.
There's also the appearance of nepotism, which comes up occasionally. So, do I have a motion to
so moved
the changes?
Second. First time I've ever gotten ahead of Henry in so many times. I can't really believe it.
Any discussion on this item? The manager was being sensitive to my concerns that we not have full-time people reporting to family members on a regular basis, particularly in a financial capacity. So, and there's nothing of that in here, so I'm very comfortable with this language now that it's written. But all in favor? Again, it's sure to be unanimous. Item 770203, Maine Department of Transportation Route 77 Project. Consideration of approval of an agreement with the Maine Department of Transportation regarding operations of construction equipment for the Route 77 paving project due to occur this spring. And the town manager can again help us out on that one.
Yes, on all state projects, the state requests municipalities to agree that the contractors of the project may exceed the weight limits that the state has set for municipalities and for construction vehicles on the roads. It's a standard procedure. The projects won't go forward without this, and I would ask that you approve the agreement and that the councilors in your capacity as municipal officers sign the agreement.
Do I have a motion?
I would like to move that be accepted. If there's a second, I'd like to make a comment.
Second.
All right. And discussion?
Last time they did a skim coat on Route 77 at sort of caught a lot of motorists in town off guard, and I think it'd be a nice gesture to provide some signs or some written notice at least a day ahead of doing this, because it ties up traffic for long lengths of time, and it was like 10 or 15 minutes. I mean, the people were waiting there. I think it would be helpful to the motoring public if they could have some notice so they could detour and go around.
Ditto.
Yeah, I would also add some concerns right around the public safety building, particularly the entrance on Jordan Way for the fire trucks. When
right.
those construction crews got there, they didn't give much leeway
right.
for those considerations, I noticed. So, ditto also.
All right. Any further discussion? All in favor of this
yeah.
motion? Again, sure to be unanimous. And item number 780203, receipt of the capital improvement plan for FY 2002 through 2008, consideration of acknowledging receipt of the CIP for the same years.
I like the picture on the cover better than I do the numbers inside. The numbers inside, as every capital improvement plan has shown for the last 10 years, shows that we're spending about $648,000 on municipal capital improvements each year, when we really should be spending $900,000 to $1.2 million. We need to cut this from $873,000 proposed in 2004 down to no more than the $648,000 that's budgeted for this year. The department heads are going to be meeting in early February to do that. We simply, our budget cannot withstand an increase of $220,000. This year, just for capital improvements. So we're going to be doing that, and it'll be part of the budget, whatever the revised recommendations are. But it's a challenge.
You have some quizzical looks, so I'll start over here, John.
So these are their recommendations to you.
That's right.
And you're going to be working
with them. Actually, we're going to do it collectively. I'm not going to. We did it last year as a collective group, and I thought it really worked while they were respective of each other's. They all made their pitches, and no one bribed anyone that I was aware of.
And it really, it was a really nice activity, a good team-building exercise, even though they were cutting, and so we're going to undertake again next month.
Councilor Swift-Cadder.
So, just to make sure I understand, so this is really sort of a first, not a first pass, but the first semi-official pass at the capital improvement plan, and it's your intent to get it down to the budgeted amount that it was for fiscal year 03.
That will be the first pass next month, subject to possible further reductions in order to reach what I'm intending to reach for a budget target prior to the budget going to the council.
Okay.
Something you'll be discussing at a workshop on Thursday evening.
Okay, thank you.
Of this week.
Then,
can we have a motion to accept the report?
I'd like to move to accept this report.
And a second?
Second.
Second from Carol. All right, all in favor? Penny? A nod down there, okay.
Right up the elbow.
Sure to be unanimous. Item number 790203, a receipt of benchmark study. Council had asked the town manager if he would try to put together some figures so we could see where we stood, and I'll ask Mike to explain what he's found a little better for us.
Yeah. If, with the council's indulgence, I'm going to speak for a few minutes on this. I think there's some important information here. And I'd much rather say publicly what I would probably say privately and not have everyone say that I'm only saying privately what I should have said publicly. If you get that, I know it sounds convoluted, but I don't want anyone to think that I'm talking behind their back, is to put it into the vernacular. This was an interesting project. Every year, the Maine Municipal Association does a fiscal survey in communities that choose to respond to it. For purposes of this study, we looked at the data that was from the year 2000, those that filled out the survey in 2001 with the 2000 data. We added to it population from the 2000 census and per capita income from the 2000 census. We could have added other data to it, but then I think biases would have come in even more than, you know, some might say that there's some biases in this. But I wanted to get that out. So then what we did is we took the top 50 communities in population size statewide that responded to the survey. So we didn't choose the communities. It was sort of the selection was those communities that responded to the survey, and there was an arbitrary cutoff of 50, but it seemed as though that would be a good place to cut off. Although it was interesting when we ended up as number one and as number at the both top and the bottom of if we had added more communities, where we would have ended up. You know, for each area we looked at, revenues and expenditures, there was a ranking blank out of 50, third out of 50, for instance, 36th out of 46, depending on some of the communities didn't respond or didn't seem applicable in certain areas. I don't think the relative position, whether one is first, second, or third, really matters. But what does matter more so is if the town is in the top quintile, the next quintile, the third quintile, the fourth, or the bottom. You know, it's more the relative positions because, you know, particularly with data, there might be one town, and I can see some instances, I saw some instances where there was just data that looked like it was out of whack. So, you know, I think that the important thing is to look at the relative position. With that, we looked at different revenues, we looked at expenditures, we looked at other. Revenue, tax commitment per capita, this is the amount that is collected from the property tax from each individual citizen of Cape Elizabeth. It's simply taking the tax commitment and dividing it by the population. We came out ninth out of 50th. How is that? You know, it's on the high side. It's in that top quintile. But then it's really, in the report is all the backup data. Listen to the towns above us in the top nine. Jay, if I recall, there's a paper mill there. Yarmouth has a big power plant. Rumford has a big paper mill. Freeport has L.L. Bean and all their warehouses in a commercial district. Camden has coastal property, but also major properties owned by MBNA. Madawaska, Fraser Paper. Bar Harbor has a commercial district, and also, you know, of course, expensive
Jackson Laboratories.
Jackson Lab, and they have a lot of seasonal homes. Falmouth is similar to Cape Elizabeth, but does have a much larger commercial district. And then there's Cape Elizabeth. So if you look simply at the taxes being paid by individual property owners, if you took out the fact that these other communities are primarily commercial, we're right at the very top. We have amongst the highest taxes in the state on a per capita basis, particularly being borne by individual residents. That obviously is a concern. As a percentage of per capita income, you know, what is our capacity to do that? We fall to 35th out of 50th. Not, you know, again, as far as the tax burden, it's not as bad. But still, it's right up there, particularly when you look at the first number. Excise tax revenue per capita, we're second out of 48. What that tells us is that folks in this car, you know, they're all the same rates everywhere in this case. They buy more expensive cars in this town than in nearly every other town, or they have more vehicles per capita than other towns. The other couple areas I'd like to mention here, recreation revenues. We're first out of the 23 communities that listed recreation revenue.
What is that?
Community services. Takes in a tremendous amount of revenues paid by the citizens. Solid waste, we're 23rd out of 33. You know, I think you really ought to study that solid waste one and see where we compare to other communities. Two pieces of good news are homestead exemption revenue per capita, we're second out of 50th, and veterans reimbursement revenue per capita, we're third out of 49th. Both of those amounts go directly to the taxpayer. Really no town involvement, and it really shows that particularly the assessor's office and the citizens have really worked together to understand those programs. And we're getting a very high return from those programs. General purpose aid education per capita, we were 36th or 46th. You know, not as bad as I thought we might have been. But again, it's important to look at the individual communities. Expenditures. You know, why is it that we're number one in, you know, particularly if you exclude the ones with major commercial district in tax commitment. You look at where are we high on this list. Education per capita, the number one expenditure of any municipality. We spend more per capita, in 2000, we spent more per capita on education than any other community in the survey. I know some of the school folks are upset with that number because we're not using per pupil cost. However, I think it should be remembered, and this is what I wanted to say publicly and wanted to be clear, that the amount that we're spending for education, by looking at per capita, unlike per pupil, we are including debt service, special ed, and transportation. And all of the numbers that are shared by school authorities statewide on per pupil, the ones that the Department of Education and Cultural Education puts out, I'm using the old name, education puts out, they're excluding debt service, they're excluding special ed, and they're excluding transportation. So, therefore, I think the per capita is a meaningful amount because it does include all those amounts, plus the fact you need to recognize with all these things, not just education, but also public works, public safety, all of the tax burden is being borne by primarily residential property tax owners, resident property tax owners, not by a commercial base and not by non-resident summer homes. So therefore, when we look at individual homeowners here in Cape Elizabeth, they are bearing a local property tax burden that's amongst the highest in the state of Maine. Where does that come from? I mentioned we're first in education. We're also first in spending on parks and recreation per capita out of 49 communities. That is because of the community services program that's very well received, gets a lot of revenue. It's because of the parks, all of the parks plus Fort Williams, and it's also because of the school grounds are funded in this amount
for Cape Elizabeth, which is about $100,000, which adds to that. The library, we're fourth or 45th. Another area that, you know, traditionally, if you look at library, education, and parks, it's been a high priority of councils and of our citizens to fund those areas. The other piece is debt service. You know, everyone comments upon our new buildings. They do reflect in these numbers. Municipal general fund debt per capita was 7th to 49th. Education debt, primarily as a result of a big school project done in the early 90s, we're 5th to 49th. You add a high municipal debt and a high education debt, and out of the 49 communities, we're third in debt per capita amongst the 49 communities that responded to that survey. So the taxes are high in Cape Elizabeth, clearly, because policy decisions have been made to fund education at a high level, to fund parks and recreation at a high level, and to fund debt at a high level. In the library, thank you, Carol. Conversely, general assistance, local welfare, we're 49th to 49th.
Thomas Jordan.
The county, we're 10th to 49th. That is a factor. Social service agencies, we're a little more supportive than some other places. We're 19th to 49th. I could go into the different areas. One thing that I found very, public works, as a percentage of per capita tax commitment. And what this really shows is what a percent of per capita tax commitment really shows how much effort we give to public works compared to something else. Public works came out 44th or 46th. We spend relatively little amount on public works on a per capita basis compared to most other communities. Police and dispatch, we appear to be a little bit high.
One question on that one. Yeah. Would that be because we do not collect rubbish primarily, and other communities may?
No, solid waste is a separate factor. This is non-public works, non-solid waste.
Okay.
Solid waste, we're 7th to 49th, and you look, a lot of the regional waste communities are high, and ironically, at the department head meeting, I forget who noted it, that the highest solid waste cost per capita in the city of Augusta. And there was this curiosity if that had something to do with state government. But anyway, we have high expenditures in a number of areas. We also looked at undesignated fund balance. We have one of the lower rates of undesignated fund balance of any community. I think, you know, this came out of a council goal. I think it's a useful exercise. I think it does provide some direction as to areas that might need further study, further evaluation. I know, for instance, that those that come out on the high side, the ones, twos, threes, and fours, might say, you know, we don't think we belong there. You know, if that is the instance, and if anyone wishes to provide, you know, additional data, I think it should be welcome. Along with that, though, is, you know, we ought to try to look at why is it that we're number one, two, three, or four. I think when the council was looking at benchmarking, they originally were thinking that what are we spending per road mile for XYZ as opposed to the more general department numbers. My sense is this gives us almost a blueprint to look more specifically at, for example, education. Why are we on the high side compared to other places? Why are we on the high side for the library? You know, what are we spending per, you know, to buy new library books? Or for staff in the library compared to others as a percentage of circulation. I think we can look at those areas. So I would like to thank the council for encouraging this to be looked at. I don't think there's probably been a town manager in the state who's ever, you know, come to a meeting the beginning of January and said the taxes in this town are high. Usually town managers don't like to say those type of things. But I think, you know, as far as the year 2000 data, the facts are inescapable. And, you know, we look at this debt per capita. Since this time, we borrowed for the police station and fire station and for the community center. The numbers have not improved. When we look at the education, other communities have gone up quite a bit, but our education budgets have gone up as well. So I think the data is relatively, you know, as valid in 2003 as it was when it was submitted in 2001. So
the public works building also in
The Public Works building was already in here. That debt had been incurred. So, you know, I'd encourage you to really study the individual tables. Look at the towns above us, below us in different categories, and particularly when you begin to look at that residential versus commercial, resident versus non-resident, it becomes even scarier than the numbers look outwardly. And I've tried not to comment on policy on how much should be being spent in certain areas, and I think I've avoided that. But I think, you know, by the very nature of what I've cited, you know, I could be, you know, some could say by pointing out certain things that I'm, you know, that there is a bias. And I, you know, I've been very careful to say these are the areas the community has traditionally valued. And I think that reflects the amounts being spent.
Thank you, I think. Councillor Carson.
I found it absolutely fascinating, this report, Michael, but we're talking about where we're located in the what was the word? The Quinn, what?
Quintiles.
You know, is it fifth, or are we eighth, or are we 12th, or are we second? But they're skewed in the sense that we're only talking about the 50 people, towns who responded. I mean, so where we're fifth in one place, if we used a different, you know, a different number of communities, depending on how many communities meet a certain property, I mean, citizen level, we might find ourselves at 25th instead of 5th. We don't know. Or we might find ourselves at 1st instead of 8th or something. So aren't they sort of skewed statistically because we've just selected 50 towns that responded to the questionnaire and it was just out of those 50, not out of any other number?
If I might, Mr. Yeah. Chairman, we didn't collect 50 towns at random. I'm sorry if I left that impression. The data is on the 50 largest communities in population.
Oh.
Who responded to the survey.
To the MMA survey.
Yeah. The 50 largest communities in population.
In population.
And they range from roughly 4,400, I think, in population, up to about 20, where's Bangor, I think, so on here.
Bangor's around 33.
Up to about 31,000 population.
But the cities are not in.
Yeah, the city.
I mean,
Westbrook, Lewiston, Portland, Sanford, Waterville, Augusta.
Sanford. Some of those are in here. Auburn, Bangor, Brewer, Brunswick, Presque Isle, Sanford. Good sized places. Yes.
Well, there's eight cities in Cumberland County as I'm going through here. Only eight, and I don't know whether 16 or, you know.
It was a survey, a study.
Yeah. It was good.
As the manager suggested, we need to look at it and study it. But at this point, I guess what we need is a motion to accept it.
Could I just ask a question, sir? Mm-hmm. When you said the municipal general fund debt per capita did not include the fire station renovation, police station.
That's correct.
Right. And the community service debt.
That came after this report was done.
Can we have a motion to accept the manager's report?
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? Or shall we leave it till later? All in favor? Sure, it could be unanimous, Deb. And before we do have at least a couple of people in the audience here, so I will ask whether, before we go to items, we go into executive session, whether there are any citizens who would like to discuss any items that are on the agenda. All right, seeing none, item number 800203, consideration of entering executive session to begin the annual evaluation of the town manager.
Before we do that, should we announce for the public the upcoming workshop dates?
I was going to do it afterwards. We can do it before, whichever
is. Okay. I didn't know how long we'd be in executive session.
I'll do it right. We can move now. Just make the announcements before we close off the cameras.
Then I move that we go into executive session for the purpose of beginning the annual evaluation of the town manager.
Second.
Very good. All in favor? And just a note to the public about meetings coming up. We can mention those. We have a council workshop on Thursday, January 17 at 7:30 at Town Hall. There's a council workshop with the school board on January 21, 7:30 p.m. at the community center to discuss proposed building projects. A council workshop with the school board on January 30th at 6 p.m. To discuss fiscal issues for the upcoming year. And the next regular scheduled meeting will be Monday, February 10, right here at 7:30. So for that, we can have the cameras closed down if they'd like, and we can move back to executive session.
And
thank you, everyone.
It's our intent that we will not be coming back on camera.
No, we will not be coming back on camera.